my computer, so I will go ahead and get us started if that's okay. So good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our talk about Junaluska, Oral Histories of a Black Appalachian Community, edited by Susan E. Keefe with assistance from the Junaluska Heritage Association. My name is Kim Sims, and I'm the coordinator of the Special Collections Research Center, which is a part of the University Libraries Appalachian. And I want to thank you all for spending some time with us this afternoon. We're excited you're here and look forward to engaging in conversation this afternoon. Before we go further, I do have a couple of things. Given the amount of individuals in attendance, we are asking that individuals who want to submit questions for our panelists that you please do so by using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Some of you have been doing that, and that's how we are going to communicate with the panelists your questions. Also, this is being recorded, and it will be made available probably on the library's website for sure, and we'll be pushing it out through our social media channels and hopefully through larger university websites and social media as well. But I can tell you, Lynn and I will make sure that we get the word out as broadly as we can on how to access this video after we get it processed and available. Also, the email you received with the link for today's event also included a link to a Google form for those of you who are interested in purchasing a copy of the book, and I recommend that you do so. There will be a book pickup this Saturday, July the 18th at 11 a.m. in the parking lot of the Watauga County Public Library. But there is an option to have your book mailed. You just need to indicate that on the form. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce to you all, or to everyone, sorry, in the audience. Joining us on the panel this afternoon are Junaluska community members, Roberta Jackson, Lynn Patterson, Brittany Ball, Betty Grimes, Sandra Hagler, and Mike Mathis. Also on the panel is Professor Emerita of Anthropology at Appalachian State, Susan Keefe, who is the book's editor. And so I'm going to start the conversation off by pretty much mimicking the structure of the book and asking Sue some contextual questions to pretty much give everyone a history of how the book came to be. So my first question, Sue, is when and how did you start working with the Junaluska community?
So I moved to Watauga County in 1978 and started teaching at Appalachian and in the anthropology department. And in the first decade of the time I was there, well, let me preface first that I was interested in ethnic studies. I had done a book on Chicano ethnicity on research that I'd done in Southern California before I moved here to Watauga County. And so I was interested in ethnic communities, and I was interested in involving my students in doing research. And so I became aware of the Junaluska community and knew that it was right here, you know, in town, within walking distance of campus. And so I originally got funding from the College of Arts and Sciences in 1988 to have a couple of my students do some interviewing in the community and in the Junaluska community. So they did, those two students did 27 interviews over the course of that summer. And then they presented professional papers at conferences, a conference that I took them to. So in the process of their doing their work, research, I came to know the community a bit. I started to attend the Boone Mennonite Brethren Church, and I started taking field notes like any good anthropologist. In the 1990s, I was contacted by a member of the Junaluska community who was concerned that their historic church, the Methodist Episcopal Church, sometimes called Boone Chapel, on Church Street Extension, was in danger of being demolished. The city had condemned it. It was a vital and active church during the 30s and 40s especially, but had declined in enrollment and stopped being used in the 1980s. But the community was really interested in preserving it. So I got my students, member of my department, Dr. Tom White, who's an archaeologist but knows something about historic preservation, involved. And we tried to make improvements to the building to ensure that it would no longer be condemned. And then, so we worked on that. We also looked at land title and discovered that the community didn't really, that we could tell, have ownership of the land. So historic preservation monies were not possible to get. And the church was ultimately demolished. But I was working closely with them in the 90s, and then in the 2000s, a couple of other community members got me engaged in some fundraising that they were doing to try to assist older residents in the community who could no longer pay their heating bills and so on. Their houses were falling into disrepair. And I worked with them, and also had a couple of students put together a map of the community with all of the residents' houses indicated on the map. I forgot to mention also, I had a student do her senior honors thesis on the Methodist Episcopal Church, Jody Manros, and then she and I published an article together on that work. And then in 2011, the St. Luke's Episcopal Church was interested in working with the Boone Mennonite Brethren Church on goals of mutual interest. And this came out of the Episcopal Church's attempt at reconciliation and justice and reparations for their participation in the slave trade. So, and their apology for that in 2008. So in 2011, a number of people from the St. Luke's Episcopal Church and the Junaluska community and the Boone Mennonite Brethren Church, which is Junaluska's church, began working together and formed this organization, the Junaluska Heritage Association. And that association, I'll let Roberta say maybe a little bit more about what that association has done. But one of the things that it was interested in, the people were interested in, especially the members of the Junaluska community, was a community history and family genealogies. They were interested in knowing where they came from. And they it's hard to do genealogical research if you're an African American with a background in slavery. So I was working with them, and they were, I think, primarily interested in the genealogical research, but I could see how their interests could also be directed toward community history, and encourage them to think about doing a community history, an oral history, and to do some more interviews. So we interviewed, I think it was 15 members of the community over a couple of years. And so it was out of that interest that we began to, as a coordinated group, work on the oral history book that we have here today. And I would have to say that the success of this book is due in many ways to not only my long-term participation with the community and their trust in me, and also our respect for working together on projects of mutual interest. And oral history was something that I could see helping them with, because oral history is very much like anthropology. So we, you know, we worked on that.
Right, and absolutely. And then, you know, special collections and archives, especially, we're big proponents of oral histories, especially for underrepresented and marginalized communities whose historic, you know, written record usually doesn't exist, or it's very, you know, scant. And so there's a lot of value in a person's narrative, absolutely. So you spoke to what prompted your working on the oral history project with the community, but what I think is really important to tell our audience today is, in the book you state that the project has been conceived from the beginning as a participatory research project. What is participatory research, and why did you choose this particular method for this project?
Yeah, you know, I taught a course called Applied Anthropology for most of the time that I was teaching at Appalachian. And so I knew about participatory development as an alternative to the more corporate development model, which is a sort of a top-down model. It's all based on science and technology and professional experts, and the success is measured by economic factors. So the participatory development model, and participatory research is part of that, that emerged in the 1990s as a reaction to, a response to the corporate development model. And in participatory development, the emphasis is on improving the participants, people who are being directly involved in the development, or recipients of the development, that they're involved in actually putting it together. And that begins with research. And so participatory research, ideally, means that the community is involved in designing the research and collecting the data, analyzing the data, and publishing the results. And so I was anxious to apply the participatory research model in this project because it suited it perfectly. And so I was interested in involving the community from the beginning. And I did that by attending their meetings when they start, when the Junaluska Heritage Association began meeting. I attended their meetings. I became the secretary, so I took the minutes, and I looked at the direction that they wanted to move in, and they were interested in making their community more visible. You know, I myself, in teaching at Appalachian, I would often ask my students if they knew about the Black neighborhood in Boone, and typically nobody had heard of it. And I think that was true in Watauga County in general. So they were interested in increasing their visibility so that and their voice in the larger Boone community. And so I worked together with them on doing that through writing and publishing the book. You know, I knew about publication. I had done a lot of editing. So I could edit the oral histories, many of which are based on two or three or more interviews. And you know, if you read an interview, you get a lot of ums and ahs, and you get the questions from the interviewer. And I wanted to turn it into a narrative that was the voice of the person speaking, being interviewed. And so that took a lot of work to edit those things. And then once I had put the narratives together, I called on the community, the Junaluska Heritage Association members and others in the larger Junaluska community to come together and help edit those narratives. And so we spent many months coming together in the Boone Mennonite Brethren Church basement, fellowship hall, and editing these narratives to make to improve their accuracy, for one thing, and to add information, and to ensure that they represented the community in the way they wanted to be represented. So they were the final arbiters of what went into the book and into the oral history narratives. There were occasions when a few things were omitted to protect the community or its members. But for the most part, they remained intact and benefited from the improved accuracy, especially in family names, genealogical relationships, and so on.
And you did research in special collections in the library at App. Will you go into some detail about what kind of research you did? Because I, for those who haven't yet seen the book, the oral histories are inclusive of oral histories done several years ago, quite a number of years ago, of individuals who are no longer here. And that's, again, it's a great overall narrative, yes, covering some. It's sorry, I really enjoyed the book, but I will turn it back over to you.
Yes, yes, the book has a brief introduction by me, which is kind of a brief ethnography or history of the community. But for the most part, the book is this collection of 36 life history narratives, and many of them were collected by Dr. Winston Kinsey in the 1970s. He was in the history department, and he interviewed 17 members of the Junaluska community, and those are in the special collections of the Urey collection. And so I was aware of those, and I didn't know there were that many, but I was aware of Reverend Rhonda Horton's interview there. Certainly he was an important leader in the community in the 20th century. And, but I needed to, you know, I began to do research to find out exactly how many of these interviews existed. And then once they were all identified, I had assistance from Greta Browning in Special Collections in digitizing many of these, which were, you know, they're originally oral tapes. And then I had students help in transcribing them. So I was working in Special Collections quite a bit. And I might mention also that Dr. Patricia Beaver and Dr. Cheryl Clausen also did a couple of interviews that are, that I were used in preparing a couple of the oral history narratives as well. And there were other people's contributions too. So that was extremely important. There was one tape that was inaudible and unusable, which was unfortunate, but we were able to resurrect many of them digitally. And also in Special Collections, they have a repository of family history booklets. These are unpublished booklets that are done by extended families for their family reunions. And they have a number of them for Black families. So I knew about those and used a number of those in doing the research for this book too.
Great, thank you. So I want to transition to asking questions of our other panelists. And I think it's important that we actually discuss and tell the attendees what the Junaluska Heritage Association, you know, is. So when was it formed and what is its mission? And so I'm not sure who to address that question to, if Ms. Jackson or Ms. Hagler or Ms. Grimes, whoever wants to jump in.
Well, I'd be glad to talk about it just a little bit, because we've been together almost 10 years. And because we have, there's a lot of things that we have done. But we began with the idea that people didn't know that our community was here. And we wanted people to know we were here and that we were a part of Boone and had been for years, well, centuries, I guess, a couple of centuries. So that was the reason why we decided to research what happened back when our mothers and before our mothers and our fathers were here. And I went into my files and looked at some of the accomplishments that we have done. And there's so many, I would bore you with them, but I'll just give you maybe one or two of them. Okay, Sue told you about St. Luke's, which is great. We have set up a website that needs to be updated, but we do have a website, and it's JunaluskaHistory.org, I think is the name of the website. Then we decided we were going to do a community quilt, and what we did is, in fact, I think Sue put it on the front of the book. That's our quilt. And it hangs in the church because we wanted to get a general idea of what things were important to us when we were children and when we were growing up. So we did that and hung it in the church. We had a great time. I learned to quilt, and I didn't know how. Then we did a large banner. For 4 years, we would do a jubilee around June 10th every year. And then we would have a jubilee where we would invite people to come so they could learn about us and we could learn about them. And we had a lot of people who participated in that situation when we were doing those. There's a lot of things we did. We would participate in the Boone Heritage Day event, which was an event that was at the Daniel Boone Gardens every year. And we'd go over there and we'd pass out information so people would know about us and that we could get used to other people we didn't know. Then we had a documentary entitled The African American Experience in the High Country. And it aired on SkyBest TV. And that was in November of 2014. And we loved that. We had a good time doing that. In 2014, we purchased some research books. The Junaluska Heritage Association did, and gave copies to the public library so that people would have those books to research. And then we gave copies to the ASU library too, so they would be there. We've been in the Western North Carolina magazine. There's been a couple of articles on us in that. I could go on and I don't want to tire you, but every year we decided we'd try to work on some project. And in 2017, it was a cemetery monument down on campus that we worked on, and with the help of ASU and a lot of other people, we got that cemetery monument put up. It'd be nice if anybody would like to go down there and see it. There's names of Black people down there who were buried down there that didn't have markers. So this monument marks their contribution to the community and where they were buried. Then last year, I think, the daughter, no, 2018, 19, the Daughters of the American Revolution met with us, and we formed a group who, Mary Moritz was instrumental in sending an application to the National DAR, and we were recognized from their group with a plaque and a lot of, we even had a church service for that one. Right now, we're working on the Carissa Hill Cemetery. That's our cemetery where our Black people are buried now. We're going to put up some new signage, and there's one more project that we met last night with the town of Boone, and they're interested in putting up a historic marker for us that comes into our community. It passed, but I'm not quite sure when it will be ready. But when it is, we'll invite everybody, or if we can have more than 25 people at that time, to come and celebrate our community. Thank you.
That would be awesome, actually. Hopefully we will get to that point again. I'd also like to point out for individuals who don't know, and I'm new to Boone myself. I moved here a little over a year ago, and I was unfamiliar with the Junaluska community until I started working in special collections. And something that I think is also really significant that the Heritage Association has done is successfully push back against government and in terms of allowing developers to come in and build apartment buildings. And so at least a couple of times now, the JHA has been successful in rezoning the neighborhood to prohibit that kind of growth, which is amazing. I'm glad you brought up the cemetery too, because that's one of my favorite places to go walk around just in general. And it's impressive. Because I as an archivist and, you know, a keeper of the records, I do recognize and understand how challenging genealogy research is for African American communities. And the book really highlights the work that Ms. Jackson and Ms. Hagler have done in researching the genealogy. And so I'm glad that we have copies of these things in special collections so that we can, you know, share them and celebrate that hard work. I did want to go back to another question for the community members specifically. And we heard from Sue, her involvement with the oral history project, but it would be, you know, if anyone would like to talk about the community's perspective of the involvement in the project and, you know, the initial reaction to the you know, proposal for the project. And you know, was it an easy buy-in for the community members given previous experience with you know, other parties interested in documenting the history of the community?
Hi, I'm Lynn Patterson. I work in the library with Kim, and it's interesting, M. Mueller, who was the man who taught us to quilt, well, he didn't teach us to quilt, but he got us back into quilting. I worked with his wife, Georgie, and Georgie said, M is interested in quilting with your mom and her sisters. And I raked him over the coals because I said, you know, they got a lot of people coming to them. They got, you know, they're retired. They want to enjoy their retirement. They don't have time for somebody else's project. So they kind of nicknamed me the gatekeeper. And not that everything had to run through me, but a lot of things have run through me as far as the projects are concerned. And I think this project was met, we all know Sue. And Sue has been an advocate and an ally for our community for as long as I've known her. When I was a student at Appalachian, my senior year, last semester, it was right before Christmas, I won't tell you when I graduated, but I did an independent study with Sue where I created my own history book. And it was my first foray into actually genealogy and looking. And my Aunt Sandy had probably one of the most complete histories that I have ever seen of the Hagler family. So that side, my mom's side, was covered, but I didn't really know anything about my dad's side of the family. And the reason being is that his grandfather and brothers were orphaned. They lived here in the county, and the father was killed and the mother left town, the boys were raised by different white families here in the county. The Perry family raised one of the youngest son. In fact, he spent a lot of time there. In fact, he settled, his family lived there as he was, as he got married and raised his family. They continued to live out in the county. But I started doing some research for Sue. I got an A on the project, which is great. But she has always been a part of our community, and she's always wanted our voice to be heard. She's always been a part of us. She's just Sue. And, you know, so it's hard for me to switch that hat when I see her on campus and she'd be Dr. Keith, but she's always been Sue to us. And I thought it was interesting. In the next generation, in doing this project, we were able to bring in, I call them the girls, they're grown women, but we're able to bring in my daughter and my niece, Brittany, who is here on Zoom with us, all the way from Atlanta, Georgia, boo-boo. We were able to bring them into this project as well. So we have 3 and 4 generations in this project. So we are so excited about it and so excited to share our stories and so excited for the opportunity to work with Sue on this project and for you guys to be recipients of who we are and what we have here.
Great, thank you. And the last question that I have here, and then we'll go look at the Q&A is, you know, what has the community's response been to the book overall? The individuals who, you know, didn't participate or who maybe, you know, were born in Boone or Watauga County, but then have, you know, left for school or jobs or something like that. What are their, what has been the response overall of the community?
I think it's been very positive. Everybody is interested in reading everybody else's story and realizing we all lived here together in the same community, a great community. When I was growing up, we didn't have much, but we didn't need much. We had each other, we had our neighbors, we stayed at our neighbors' homes. And to read some of the stories really makes me feel good. And I found out where people went. When I got married and had children, what happened to these other people I was growing up with? And this is a good way to find out. Now, my son, he loves the book. He told me, you didn't say anything about me in the book. I did. And he said, well, why wasn't I asked to participate? And that's the problem. A lot of people won't participate, even when you ask them. So we went with who we got.
Yeah, that makes total sense. That's funny, though. Thank you for sharing that anecdote with us. I do have one question in the Q&A. Ms. Jackson, you mentioned the cemetery that the association is currently working on, not the town cemetery that's surrounded by the campus, but the current cemetery. Would you repeat the name of that cemetery, please?
It's Clarissa Hill, Clarissa Hill Cemetery. And it's in the western part of Boone.
OK, Okay, great. And I would like to share with the attendees that Diane, who is a member of the Junaluska Heritage Association, wanted us to state that another reason the association was formed was to ward off unwanted development in the neighborhood by raising its visibility and hopefully engendering a desire in the town of Boone and its residents to protect it. So thank you, Diane. And we have...
I could also say that, if I can jump in.
Sure.
That the mission of the Junaluska Heritage Association is to preserve the community as well as its cultural heritage. So.
Sorry, I just muted myself. My apologies. This question is, it says, I live in a rural part of Virginia. A group has recently formed to lift up the voices of African Americans in our county and record oral histories of the Black residents. How can we get people of color involved in this project? What strategies did you use?
I think Sandra Hager would be a good person to discuss that because she's kind of like our community historian, if she will.
Now, Bert, I am so glad to be here. And the reason I'm saying I'm so glad to be here was because about 6 months ago, I was sick with COVID-19. And I was not expected to make it back. Wasn't expected to get my voice back, but it's back. And I have been interested in our history since I was a child. And the reason is because my dad, who of course has passed now, would tell stories of things that happened in the community. And I asked my sister Louise and Roberta if they heard these stories, and they said they did not. But I heard a lot of them. And so when I was working at ASU, I decided I would try to do some research about the Blacks in this county, and there really was no research. I mean, Black people were invisible, and they didn't count, but we know that Black lives do matter. What I'm in the process of doing, and have been for the past few years, is doing a community genealogy history, which we are working on. And as Lynn said, she didn't know much about the Whittington, her father's side of her family, but I'm sure she does now because she has done a lot of research. We have a lot of families we're working on. Roberta's working on them, Lynn, me, and others, many others are helping. And I hope they're, I need, and I'm sure this is not answering any questions, but we need someone that can edit and type up our histories. We had a person that was here for several years, Shannon Perry, but she has moved, and so now we have no one. And I'm not good at typing. I can write longhand very well, but I don't type well. So we need someone. If anybody would like to help, let us know. Thank you.
Can I jump in, Kim? It's good to have you back, Sandy.
Thank you.
Your voice sounds as strong as ever. I'm so pleased to hear that. But I would say that for those folks in Virginia, that the first thing that they need to do is to become acquainted with the Black community in their county and to find the resource people that are there. So when we started working on this book about 10 years ago or so, Sandy Hagler and Roberta Jackson were obviously key to making headway and to finding out, you know, what stories needed to be told. So you have to go to the communities. You have to show up. And it may take time. You know, I heard many, many stories in Junaluska of the frustration of community members with people who would come into the community, want to do some research, you know, do some what they called, Junaluska people called drive-by interviews, you know, and then they'd leave. And the community members would never hear from them again or know what was happening with this information. So, you know, there's a lot to overcome in doing this kind of project. You have to become basically a member of the community. You have to be there, you have to show up, and you have to become involved in things they're interested in. And that's how you gain trust. So if there is a public library in your county, the librarians probably know a lot about the county and about people who are interested in local history and so on. And you could get direction there about how to become involved. And you have to listen to community members. So you can't come in with your agenda, you know, and say, you know, we want to, for example, replicate what was done in Junaluska. Well, that may or may not be on the community's mind. So you have to work with them. It takes time, it takes trust, and it takes honoring the ideas and the voices and the goals of the ethnic community you're working with.
And we did a lot of census work. That's where you could find a lot of your information was, and then you could put stories together that way. But we always found that if it said this and we couldn't find document of it anywhere else, that we couldn't say, yes, this is the way it happened. We had to be able to prove what we were looking for. And most of the times you can, then sometimes you can't. I was researching a lady. I couldn't find anything on this lady. And I went to bed one night and dreamed that I went to her house. I asked her to come out and she wouldn't come out and talk to me. And I thought, you've gone a little too far. You're going to have to stop for a while. So I did, because I didn't, it was getting to be too deep. But one thing I like to say, one thing I found out about our people in past years, they were great, strong people. They were people that, if I had known part of them, I really would have looked up to them. But researching the history is great because it's very rewarding.
If I can jump in again too, I don't think we've mentioned that the life history narratives in our book are from people born between 1885 and 1993. So it really does cover more than 100 years of the history of this community. And you do discover, you know, a lot of the people were born in Boone, but many people came here from other places, mostly adjacent counties, but other communities. There were Black communities in Watauga County outside of Boone, three major ones, Beaver Dam and Vilas, especially. When you are thinking about a community and what to research there, there are lots of choices to be made and lots of possible pathways. So in this case, we focused on Junaluska, but we could have focused on Watauga County, you know, and looked at it from that perspective.
Right. I have a question in the chat about, it's for Brittany. It says, what have you done with this project? Brittany was, and still is, an educator. She's a teacher. And I know that she used some of this in her classroom. Brittany, could you talk about your history work in the classroom?
Sure. So obviously I grew up in the Junaluska community, and all the people that are on the panel for the most part are either my aunts or my grandmothers. So I grew up in the neighborhood, went to the Junaluska, different events that happened in our neighborhood, and always in the church. So, of course, I've heard a lot of the stories, but one of the biggest things was that we were in the North Carolina magazine for our history, our state, or whatnot, and so I used that in my classroom. I was, like, amazed. This was the first time I really had seen that we were acknowledged as a community, one of the oldest communities in the western part of the state, and so I think it's important for our voice to be heard, and I have my narrative in the book as well. One of the things that I do talk about, because I saw someone else had a question about how it's affected me, is that my generation has started to kind of move out of the neighborhood. So there's not really a lot of us that still live in the neighborhood. It's still, you know, the older generations and our parents and our grandparents and our aunts and uncles. And so my biggest thing about this book is that it's going to preserve our history, that even if 100 years from now, none of us are in that neighborhood anymore, which I hope that's not the case. But if that's the case, we still have a piece of our history to be told, and a piece of our history that can be told in schools, and so that people know that Boone does have a strong community there. That is the biggest thing about the Junaluska community, is that we stick together and we're all family regardless of what our last names are, and we always can depend on each other. So I guess the biggest way this has affected me is that I know that our stories will still be told, and that they will still exist for those people to know that we were there. So that's my biggest, I guess, accomplishment, and that makes me the happiest about this, because even for myself moving away, I still, that's my home and that's my town. So I'm just proud that this book was able to be published and that our history will live on.
Wonderful. Thank you. Someone has asked specifically to Sue and Miss Jackson about the best way to contact you regarding starting a conversation about a project that would enhance the awareness of the JHA, and I'm happy to contact them privately with your email addresses if that's preferred, but I didn't want to let the question go.
Both Roberta and I have appstate.edu addresses.
Okay, so yes. You should be found in the directory pretty easily. I know. Okay.
Yes.
So to the individual asking the question, if you go to appstate.edu and go up to the right corner with the directory, you can search by people, and you should be able to find them. But if not, contact me. I'm in there. What is my address? SimsKD@appstate.edu, and I can help you navigate that. All right, thank you. We have quite a number of other questions. This should be a quick one to answer, so I'll go ahead and ask it. Someone said they just ordered the book. Who do they make the checks out to? That's an important question to answer. Who should they make the check out to? To the JHA?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so please your check out to the Junaluska Heritage Association.
Association. Yes.
And let's see. And Diane, I wanted to make another comment that Sue Keefe has worked very hard over many years to make sure that participants' voices were accurately reflected, and that Diane has heard Sue call it bottom-up research. In the past, researchers have done interviews with Junaluska residents, and sometimes the people never saw the final product or heard from them again. And as Sue reflected, Virgil Greer, a longtime resident of the community, now sadly deceased, said firmly, "No more drive-by interviews." Thank you, Diane. And there is an individual who would like to know more about the history of Junaluska. How and when did the community form? The individual has heard that Junaluska, you know, had its own businesses within the community. So what happened to those businesses? Would someone like to give some more information about the history of the
You want me to speak, everybody?
Sure. Go ahead.
So, in the introduction to the book, I discussed the history of the community. It was formed in the 19th century. And as far as we can tell, given the research that we've done on the community, it's one of the oldest African-American communities in Western North Carolina. So it is a very well-established community. The origins of the neighborhood itself are unclear, but the street that the Boone Mennonite Brethren Church is located on was originally called African Street. So I think we can assume that African Americans have lived in the neighborhood since before the turn of the century. It could quite possibly have been the location where some of the Jordan Council Jr.'s slaves had quarters, because he's known as the father of Boone, and he donated the land for the first courthouse on Depot Street. His store, council store, was on Depot Street, and his slaves. He was one of the largest slave owners in Watauga County. Probably lived nearby. But the community itself, members of the community itself, have always said, they probably just stuck us up here because it was worthless land on the side of the mountain. And little did they know that in the 21st century, it would be very desirable land because it has a beautiful view of downtown and campus, and it's, within walking distance of everything. So anyone else want to add something to that?
I'll just add just a little. When I was doing, and a lot of us were doing our research, with our people in this area as early as when they started taking census. So Black people have been in this area for as long as, I guess, the white people have been in this area. It's just that we weren't as visible. Some of the people on the census were born in 1790s, which would make, they were pretty old, and they had been brought up here from down under the mountain for people to help people with their farming and things like that, and people just stayed. But this is a pretty old community. And some of the stores died out when the owners died out and weren't started back up. I know my grandfather had a little store, and he sold candy, drinks, ice cream, things like that that people could buy in the community without having to go outside of the community. So for a long time, this is where we spent our life. It's right here in this community. We didn't go off the hill, as we say, until we were teenagers. We didn't know anything about white people. So I'm sure white people knew about as much about us as we did about them. But we have found that we live very well together. And now our community is a mixed community. There's as many white probably here as there are blacks. But it's still, it's home.
That's one of the things that I'll say about our current neighbors is that they seem to know what our community is and what it means, and they're very respectful of our history and our heritage, and we appreciate that for our current neighbors that are on here. Also, people, especially the students, have asked me why we no longer have the stores. Well, I think it probably, not just in Junaluska, but just probably all across the country, desegregation allowed us not to be forced to have to maintain our own stores and our own restaurants. We were allowed, when we were allowed to integrate, we did. And it's just like now, it's so much easier for me to go to Stickboy than to create my own bakery. I mean, I wouldn't mind having it, you know, that's my lifelong dream, but it's easier for me to go to Stickboy than it is for me to get up at 4 a.m. and make my own cinnamon rolls. So I'm not saying that the desire isn't there, because we do, even now, still have business owners within the community. It's just that with things being different and life being different, you know, the need for us to have our own businesses is not as prevalent as it was then. We were a community in a community is what I've heard my Aunt Sandy say before. And that was out of necessity, not because, you know, that was what we needed.
Okay, Brittany, we have another question for you. The person says that they're sure you've heard many of the stories in the book and you know many of the people who are represented, but is there anything that surprised you about the completed project? And I'm not sure, I'm thinking that means, was there something surprising you've maybe learned about an individual or a story you hadn't heard?
Yeah, I mean, all of the stories, the people that were before me, you know, were very interesting stories, and the dynamic of how things have changed in our neighborhood and how some things have kind of stayed the same as far as like things that we value or things that we do as a community. So I would say just reading through all of them were really eye-opening and surprising to me. There's nothing that I didn't learn by reading through other people. So I learned a lot of different things by reading other people's narratives. Even my little cousin Elena, I loved her narrative. There were things in there, and she's younger than me, that I just didn't know that I was surprised about. So I thought that that was interesting. The whole book is just phenomenal because you learn, I don't think anybody knows every single thing from our neighborhood's history. So having that to go back and read, you're gonna learn something every time, so.
Thank you.
I also say that, you know, you learn a lot just about the history of Boone and Watauga County, reading the accounts of the people in the book. And anybody who has lived in Boone for some time will find lots of things that they identify with that the individuals talk about. Because most of them worked in the town of Boone at various stores. They worked for servants for white families in the neighborhoods nearby. They worked on campus at ASU. And so you read about Dee Dee Doherty. You read about, Jim Holzhauser, former governor of North Carolina. Individuals are mentioned so that anybody who's interested in local history would be interested in this book, I think, because you get African Americans' perspective on it.
Absolutely. We had an individual ask about what issue of the Our State magazine that the article about Junaluska can be accessed, and I found it. It's February 2015. And it's the URL is ourstate.com/Junaluska. So there you go. And I hope that helps. And someone asked, where did the name Junaluska originate?
Hey, Kim, just to backtrack a little bit, I wanted to tell you about how we ended up in Our State magazine.
And yeah,
we had the editor of Our State magazine come and speak at the library one time. And I was in charge of driving her back and forth to lunch. So, you know, I was like, you know what? This is a perfect opportunity for me to pitch my community to her for a little story. So I was telling her, well, you know, we're the oldest African-American mountain community. And, we've been here, we can trace our roots back to the 1700s. And, you know, the whole time I'm driving her, she's looking at me like, yeah. So I was like, she's not going to do anything. And then the very next summer, she comes up and just camps out in Special Collections and does research. And then we end up in the magazine. So I was, I'm not saying that I was instrumental in that, but I aggravated her to the point that she had to look it up. She didn't have any other choice. But that was a highlight for us. It was exciting for us to be featured in that magazine. And another thing that I found in my research, and I shared it with Brittany for her classroom, is that not only do we have a footprint here in one of the oldest African-American communities, but in Texana, North Carolina, which is down near Murphy. Texana was my great-great-grandmother, Brittany's great-great-great-grandmother. So we have a footprint in both communities. So we've been mountain people for a long time.
Thank you. So, Sue, I think you mentioned in the book, you touch on the origin of the name or what exists. Would you mind answering that question?
Yeah. I would say that the name Junaluska, according to members of the community, seems to have come about, you know, in the 1970s. As one person said, it might have been Sandy. It's when the town started getting interested in the community because it had been pretty neglected. But so the name Junaluska is fairly recent for the community. They always referred to it as the hill. The community, according to Reverend Rhonda Horton, at one time, early in the 20th century, the community went from Queen Street all the way up to Howard's Knob. So the lower part is called the Hill, and that's where the Boone Mennonite Brethren Church is located and so on. The upper part is up Junaluska Road, and Junaluska Road was built in, I think, the 1920s, and I assume took the name then. But there was also a person who lived at the top of Howard's Knob, Samuel Underwood, who was Polly Grimes' grandfather, I think. And Polly Grimes is one of the matriarchs of the community. A lot of people in the community are descended from her. So Samuel Underwood had a nickname of Chief Junaluska. Chief Junaluska was the Cherokee chief of the Eastern Band of Cherokee in the 19th century. So there are lots of possibilities about where the name came from, but, you know, a lot of people in the book talk about their Cherokee ancestry and mention having family members, grandfathers and so on, who were Native American. And of course, you know, so in terms of the ancestry of people in the community, it's Black and white and Native American, but they identify pretty much as Black.
Polly Grimes and her family were really from Ashe County. And it's like Sue said, a lot of people surrounding counties end up moving into Boone. But that's where that Grimes family came from. And they are definitely related to Indians. They have a lot of Cherokee in them. And you can tell that probably by looking at them, that they're a mixture of Cherokee, Black, and whites.
Okay, so one of the questions that came in a little while ago is, what would make it easier for people to stay in or return to the community?
Would you repeat that?
Absolutely. What would make it easier for people to stay in or return to the Junaluska community?
Go ahead. No, go, dear. Go.
Well, I just was speaking, when I spoke about that earlier, I was speaking from the perspective of just opportunities, of things that we can do. So, you know, when you go to college, or even if you don't, you have other opportunities of leaving to just pursue those things, or to get married, or to meet new people. That's what you do. So I don't think it's something that people move away because they were trying to get away from it. I think they're just moving because there's other opportunities that present themselves to those people. So, I mean, Junaluska is always my home. That's always my community. So I plan to come back there as often as possible. But, you know, I just happened to move because other opportunities came available to me personally. So I don't think it has anything to do necessarily with trying to get people to come back. Everybody will come back. That's our home. But just the opportunities that present themselves.
And that's the way it's been throughout our history. There's many people that have left here, and it wasn't necessarily, it was for different reasons. They had different reasons for leaving. But opportunities has always been one of the main problems here. I guess it depends on what field you go into. Bert was into teaching, and my sister Louise and I were nurses. So there wasn't a problem with us getting a job. But for children under us and then under them, it's harder and harder. There's not much to draw them here to make them want to stay, because they need to make a living, raise a family. Thank you.
And I would also say that, you know, the community is in large part a result of segregation and Jim Crow laws and, you know, American history that has prevented African Americans from taking advantage of opportunities in the same way that white people have had. So if you read about the community in this book, you realize that it was a warm, supportive environment for people. People felt secure, they felt loved. They had their own school, of course, because it was segregated schooling. They had their own churches. So for the times of segregation, they felt pretty good about themselves. But as society has changed, as the kinds of opportunities that have been available to whites have become available to people of color, I don't think we can expect them to stay put. I certainly don't live in the community I grew up in. Yeah, so.
There's a question on here that said, that asked really, well, two questions actually. One that says, how did the segregation go in the area, easy or challenging? And Brittany, I got the same problem. And do you know if there was ever redlining in Boone? And I can't really answer the question about desegregation. I think I'll leave that to Mom and Aunt Betty, who's been very quiet, and Aunt Sandy. And but I can only tell you my experience after the schools were integrated. And I was one of the first children of color, to attend Hardin Park Elementary School. The first year it opened, I went there as a kindergartner. And I remember our parents were kind of worried about us. I mean, because they had been to school where they were all together. And some of the pictures of their schooling and what they did when they were in school, I'm jealous. I'm gonna be completely honest, because they had plays, they had, even though they were separate, they had a quality, rich education. And you can kind of tell that in us and in our children, because education is very important. And, you know, we have master's degrees, and we have doctorates within our community. Education is key for the people in the Junaluska community. But as far as the segregation is concerned, they can answer that question. I think a lot of it depended on the fact that the church that stayed the longest was Mennonite, and Mennonite brethren are pacifists, so that has a lot to do with it. So I'll let them weigh in on that question.
Well, I was old enough that I missed that. Schools were integrated in 1964, and that was the year I graduated. So I went on to college, so I didn't have that kind of experience. I know Sandy did, and she can tell you about that.
I guess because we were raised so to ourselves. We were just such a small group of children. We had our own school, our own teachers, and to be suddenly sent to a school out of our community to ride a bus with all these other kids. It was, I can't think about it without tears, because it was the saddest day of my life. It was more than I could handle. I could not adjust to it. So, and I think we were seniors that year, my sister and I, and Betty, and it was a gang of us, but it was such a heartbreaking year. And I quit school before graduation. I went back and did my GED and that way, but it was a horrible experience for me. The teachers didn't want us. The students didn't want us. I have never felt so unwanted in my life. And I am so glad it was not that way for our children. They went to Hardin Park from day one. They had children of all races, friends. But for us, it was horrible. For me.
I think also some people said that the boys had the most difficult time when integration began. And a lot of them, there were a lot of fights in the schools. And so many of them didn't stay in school in that early period of integration.
We always thought the boys had it easier, and they would come by and look us up and ask us, is anybody giving you any trouble? Has anybody been mean to you? And we thought they had it better. We felt like we had it really bad. But they were good boys.
So we had a question asked for us to ask of you. I don't want to get to it. Just real quick. What phrase did you use to describe your research methodology? This individual is a folklorist, and they call their research methodology collaborative ethnography, and they want to know, is it the same thing?
Well, I mean, that sounds like a good term. it expresses the same thing, I think, that I was talking about when I was talking about participatory research. So, I mean, the point is that that you pursue in a collaborative way the research. And so decisions are made by everyone. Yeah.
Okay. And I'll just read the question. It says, why has there been so little emphasis on the initiatives that the community made long before it became a research project. And I'm not sure if the research project refers specifically to the oral histories, or not, but it just says, why has there been so little emphasis on the initiatives that the community made long before it became a research project?
Well, I think there has been, you know, we had a committee member that said the other day that if you don't know about Junaluska, you haven't been reading the papers, because for the past 10 or 11 years, we've really been getting stuff out there. We've really been pushing the community and our history and what we're about and our legacy and what we've done for the town. And we've been very, very blessed in the fact that the university has also embraced us getting our legacy and our history and our story out. This is just one project. I mean, it's a great project and I love it, but this is just one of the many projects that we've done. In fact, the cemetery project was huge because, you know, not to downplay anything else that we've done, but we saw a problem. The students on campus, on Appalachian's campus, in fact, I told the story to, accidentally told the story to someone who were a colleague that I worked with and some students, and students grabbed a hold of this and said, hey, there's a whole cemetery of people of color up there with no markers and people sunbathe on it and it's disrespectful. And we want to do something. So they raised the first money that we even raised to for the cemetery marker. They gave the first, what, $1,000 for the cemetery marker. We're in the papers. We have our own website. But as a community, we're not very loud people. You know, we're here and we know who we are and we know what we contributed to Boone. We know what we contribute, we continue to contribute to the Appalachian community and to the county and to the town. And we're here, you know, but just because we're not screaming it from the top of the mountain doesn't mean that our contribution isn't as important as anyone else's.
And I would have to say that, you know, the fact that three of our panelists, you know, we can't see their faces. You know, that's kind of indicative of the community. The community is reticent to blow their own horn or, you know, make a big fuss. And I think maybe some of that comes from their Mennonite heritage, where you're humble, you know, before God. You know, the cemetery project, the town of Boone took over the Boone City Cemetery in 2016. Well, that happened in large part because the Junaluska Heritage Association wrote a letter the Historic Preservation Commission of the town of Boone, complaining about the state of affairs at the historic Black Cemetery. The Boone City Cemetery was always segregated, and the Black section was outside the fence. It looked like a grassy knoll. There were only a handful of tombstones there. And after we prompted the city to take a look at that state of affairs, the town of Boone took ownership of the cemetery, the entire cemetery, the Black and the white sections, and put a fence around the entire cemetery, built a retaining wall that was on the end where of the Black cemetery that was kind of falling in, cleared the land of trees and so on that had grown up, and then celebrated the fact that the JHA placed the cemetery marker there. You know, we knew that there were 65, we knew 65 individuals' names who were buried there because we had courthouse records that Sandy had collected. But the courthouse, the 19th century courthouse, burned down and all the records with it. So we didn't know about individuals from the 19th century. Well, it turned out the town of Boone did, now I've forgotten the term, where they determined what kinds, whether or not there were burials in the on the property. And they found 165 burials in the Black Cemetery. So there, you know, there were a lot of individuals whose names we don't have that were buried there. And it's, you know, it's all of that got initiated because the Junaluska Heritage Association prompted the Historic Preservation Commission to look into it. So I think, you know, in terms of initiatives, I'd say the Junaluska Heritage Association has done a lot. Ground penetrating radar, that's what I was trying to think of. That's the technique they use to determine how many burials are actually there.
You know, one of the things I also, I work with a lot of students and spend a lot of time with students on campus. And one of the things that I try to stress to them that it's okay to be angry. It's okay to protest. It's okay to stand up for your rights. But at the end of the day, you have to figure out how, well, I say, and flip the table, but you have to figure out how to write that table, sit down and actually express what it is you need and what you want. And when you write that table, when you sit down, when you use your words and articulate what your needs and desires are, then people can come to the table and meet you, and change can happen that way.
Okay, we had a couple of comments. One, Henson Chapel United Methodist Church says that there's a statue of Chief Junaluska at Lake Junaluska Methodist Conference Center, they believe. And the comment was made that jobs would help preserve Junaluska as well as the rural areas of Watauga County. And then had the question, it says, well, it starts off with the comment, what an amazing gem to have those oral histories preserved. Has the book opened up the historical information that some were looking for from a genealogy standpoint? In other words, did the oral histories open up information that traced back pre-slavery?
We hope so. That's one of our goals, to show people that this can be accomplished if you work at it, if you do it. And I do recommend for the group in Virginia, maybe they need to start with an organization like the Junaluska Heritage Association that has a goal in mind before they start. It helps to have other people with you. If we hadn't had the people, Sue, Diane, Kristen, Andrea, all the people, teachers at ASU that we've had, we wouldn't be as far along as we are now. We really appreciate their efforts.
We haven't mentioned Kristen Dethridge, but she is a member of the Junaluska Heritage Association also, and in the Department of History at ASU. And Anne Blanks has worked with us from day one also with the JHA, so she's a community member.
I'm not sure if the Midnight Brethren Church is mentioned much in the book. But the day I got my book, my son-in-law said, oh, could I read it? I haven't read it yet. No, but I don't know if the Midnight Brethren Church itself is featured much in the book, because it has quite a big part in our community. I'm not sure. Is it so?
Yes, and there's the 1918 picture of the church and the contemporary picture of the church, and quite a long discussion of Reverend Rhonda Horton and Reverend Rock Hatton, two charismatic preachers
right
from that church.
Thank you, Sue.
And a little bit about the history of the Mennonite the Crimmer Mennonite Brethren who came to Western North Carolina to establish schools and then churches in this region, so that today there aren't very many African-American Mennonite Brethren churches in the United States, but most of them that exist are right here in Western North Carolina. There's six that still remain, but at one time there were 13. So
that originated in Avery County. There's a question in the chat about Avery County. So we have very strong Avery County ties, and it's kind of cyclical in nature because our current pastor, Mike Mathis, hasn't said anything, is from Avery County originally as well.
The Mennonite Church of Boone was before Avery.
Reverend Mathis should say something.
I'm coming in. Thank you. Yes, I came to Boone in 2014, and Junaluska Heritage Association was already started and well on its way. And I'm just, you know, when I'm sitting and I'm listening, I have to mention the Junaluska Gospel Choir. If you've ever been around Boone or anywhere in Watauga, Avery County, I know you've heard of the Junaluska Gospel Choir. And one thing I would say about the Mennonite Brethren that are left, there's only two pastors that are originally Mennonite Brethren, and that would be myself and Dr. Terry Hunt down in Lenore. The other pastors that have that are pastoring now have come from other denominations. We are the only two that were brought up and raised in the Mennonite Church. Reverend Rhonda Horton, whose name certainly is in the book, is one of my mentors. Him and Reverend Hatton, Reverend Horton appointed me when I was 11 years old to be acting deacon at the Beach Bottom Mennonite Church. He was a big part of my life. He gave me my Bible in 1969 when I graduated from Avery County High School. He has been a big part of my life. His name is known not only in Western North Carolina, but throughout the United States. If you go to our headquarters in Kansas and you mention Rhonda Horton, everybody knows who he and Rock Hatton are. So one thing about the Junaluska community and why it is so fluent is because of the leadership of these men that were rooted and grounded in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that's what they taught. They built this community on God's plan, and I think that's why it still remains as strong as community as it is today. And we strive as it was said earlier, we don't really brag about what all that's been done because you know, that's not what it's about. It's because of the God that we serve. He certainly deserves all the recognition. Somebody asked one of our members one time, how long had they served? And they said, well, it's been quite a few years. Because if they would have told them the years that they had been in service, it was felt like they were bragging, just like you would say, well, I taught for 30 years. They would never answer you like that. They would answer you, well, it's been a long time, because they believe if they said that I've been in service for 30 years, it meant that they were bragging, and that's just not what they're rooted and grounded in. So, yes, these two men that I knew growing up was certainly a big part of my life, and I am so proud of the Junaluska Heritage Association to be a part of it, and also to be able to be the minister there in this great Junaluska community. I love this community with all my heart. I thank God for what he's doing there, still in the community, how we continue to grow. We may not grow in numbers, but we are growing in unity. Our community is coming together, and one thing we've saw a lot of families being brought back together and being bonded closer together because of love. And I think it's because of the Junaluska Heritage Association and all the work that has been done. I even saw Dr. Kira, I think I saw her even tear up a little bit because the work that she has done is certainly has been heartwarming to us as a community. And we thank her and all the members of the Junaluska Heritage Association that has worked so hard and made so much progress there in this community. And it has not gone unnoticed. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Professor Dethridge commented saying regarding the redlining, specifically zoning regulations in rural towns like Boone are typically quite different from urban ones. She hasn't seen evidence of redlining here in Boone, but she's trying to find out. It would require access to some privately held records like mortgage lending policies from banks that no longer exist. But it doesn't mean that more under the table de facto mortgage redlining didn't happen here, only that it hasn't been proven yet. So thank you, Professor, for that. An individual wanted to know if there was any way to investigate further who was buried in the cemetery, since the cemetery records, if I understood you correctly, Sue, burned in the courthouse fire. But given that some of that information, you know, would be before death records were required and mandatory, it would require potentially death notices and newspapers and or Bible, you know, records found in Bibles, that sort of thing. But have our researchers on this panel been able to uncover names using pulling together resources from various places outside of official, you know, records?
The funeral home, Austin and Barnes, the funeral homes. I've tried to contact
Raines Sturtevant.
Which one?
Raines Sturtevant.
Raines Sturtevant, yes. That's probably the oldest one. And what I found is that they didn't start keeping death certificates until 1932, which really threw us way off. I mean, we could find some death certificates earlier than that, but they didn't keep them. They didn't, you would have to go through the state of North Carolina to try to find some. And even going to the state of North Carolina, there was one guy was trying to find his death certificate, and they didn't have it. He was one of the Horton boys that was killed in the Horton incident, and there was not a death certificate for him anywhere. We know it was in 1932 in November, but as far as the actual death certificate, we could never find one. It was the article in the Democrat in November of 1932 that he had passed away. And that's how we came across with his date of death. But nothing as far as the actual death certificate. And I'm not sure why, because he actually died in Avery County. Of our Grace Memorial Hospital, I think it's in Avery. And he died there. And so we thought for sure, Bert and I went over there one day to see if we could find his death certificate. And the lady there was very nice, and she's the one that sent to Raleigh to see if Raleigh could send us a copy, but they didn't have one. So we don't know what happened. He didn't have a death certificate. And it is late as 1932. He should have had one. His brother that was killed in September of that year had a death certificate, but not for the one that died in Avery County. But funeral homes are a good way to look up death certificate, especially if you have a name and an idea about the time of death or a birth, you can go through them. The clerk of court, we spend a lot of time at the Register of Deeds and over there looking up death certificates and marriage license. And of course, you don't have to go over there now. You can pull them up on the computer. But at that time, we had to make trips over there to go and look up marriage licenses and things like that. We found a lot of information over there.
Thank you. So I know the book talks about this, and someone asked, is any part of the community on the historical register?
No. The oldest church, the Methodist Episcopal Church, as I mentioned, I think that was torn down. And that was built in 1898. The Boone Mennonite Brethren Church is still there. It was built in 1918, but it has vinyl siding. It was put on in the 1980s, and so it does not qualify for the historic register. There was a survey done by Trent McGriff of the architecture in the community in 2012, I think. And one of the oldest structures that he found was a house on the corner of North Street and Depot Street. It was probably built in the late 19th century, according to architectural style. But the problem is, you know, that many of the homes that were built in that early period are no longer with us because they didn't have cement foundations or they didn't survive very well.
The Watauga Consolidated School, which is on Church Street, was built in 1937, and that was built during the WPAW, that government program to give people work, and that one was built in 1937. I don't know of any buildings older than that. I'm sure some of the houses are, but I don't know.
Okay, yeah, and Diane wanted to add that the church might qualify, the Mennonite church might qualify for the historic register, but the vinyl siding would have to be removed and replaced with wood siding, and that would require a lot of ongoing upkeep. It's getting about a little over 15 minutes until 6. I don't know. We didn't ask our panelists to keep going on and on, but this is awesome. We have one more comment and two more questions, and then maybe we can let people go to dinner and or eat dinner and that sort of thing. But the comment is that there are many anecdotal accounts of Black folks outside of Junaluska being denied leases, mortgages, and housing once folks realized that they were Black. Thank you for that comment. And then one question is, so are the Jacksons in Avery County related to the Jacksons in Junaluska? The individual who's asking this. Okay. She's trying to learn, she's from Avery, and she's trying to learn more about the Black heritage in her community.
She should talk to Pastor. Because that is his community, is the Avery community. So, but yes, we are related.
Right, thank you. And the last question that we have is someone asked, what was the Horton incident?
Kim, I just put into the chat panelists the newspaper article about the Horton incident. Long story short, it was a lynching of two African-American men and the aftermath and what happened in the community afterwards. My Aunt Sandy has written a paper about the Horton incident, and it was at one time in the public library in our files down there. I'm not sure if it's still there. And I'm not sure if we have a copy in the library, but we should. But Eric Flagg is also a strong proponent about the incident as well. But my Aunt Sandy can answer that question right now.
I thought there was a copy at Watauga County Library. And I don't know if Sue added, I don't think Sue added anything like that to her oral history, but we will be adding that and other incidents into our genealogy when we get it finished. There are several incidents of things that happened in the Junaluska community. Like I said, my dad told me about them when I was little. And when I grew up and I went and looked up the newspapers, I found the very same articles. Of course, there's a different slant to the newspaper telling than the community's telling. But it's definitely there for reference about the Horton incident. And it's September 1932 and November of 1932. If anybody would be interested in reading the newspaper account.
Yes, this is described in the book.
Oh, is it? Okay.
It is, Sandy, yeah. And the newspaper accounts, of course, are from the town of Boone's perspective. And the incident, as it's described in the book, is from the Junaluska community's perspective, I think. And it relies to some extent on Sandy's description. But several of the narrators in the book, in the oral histories, discuss the incident, which, interestingly enough, has only been referred to as a lynching fairly recently. And that was really in large part this was an incident of terror in the Black community and led to a lot of, in large part, I think, led to the community's reticence in terms of participating in the larger town of Boone. But in the process of doing the research for this book, we discovered that that Ralph Horton is listed with the Peace and Justice Memorial in Alabama, I think it is, which memorializes all those African Americans who were lynched in the United States. And and so lynching refers not just to hangings, but to illegal killings of murders of African Americans. And so Ralph is there on the tombstone for Watauga County.
Is there any way that we could get his brother added?
Well, if the community were interested, I mean, this is something for the community to decide. If the Junaluska Heritage Association were interested in seeing Norwood Horton's name added to that tombstone, that is something we could pursue because we have collected a lot of information now, including oral histories in this book.
Right. It would be wonderful.
Someone has asked about where the location is of the cemetery that we're talking about, or y'all are talking about, and Lynn has answered that for them. Thank you, Lynn. Okay, well, are there any comments that the panelists, any of you want to share with attendees before we end?
I would just like to say, Kim, thank you so much for organizing this, and Lynn, appreciate it very much. And I appreciate all the panelists being here. It's wonderful. Thank you.
Well, I would like to thank you all for sharing your stories, because they are your stories to share. And again, the book is just, it's a really good read. It's very informative. I like how you get all this contextual information that just enhances, you know, what you read then with the firsthand accounts of the individuals who were, you know, willing to share their stories. Thank you also to Brittany and Lynn for showing us your dogs. That was awesome for blessing us. And on a personal note with the pastor, it's almost enough to make me want to start going back to church. That was wonderful. So if there's nothing else, again, we will have the recording available really soon. I don't want to put a time limit on it for, you know, because it's some work that other people have to do outside of Lynn and myself, but we will get it published on the web, the library's website, through whatever social media.